Hi, Eva Nichols here. Today we're going to talk color and we're going to do a new color wheel. Not based on red, blue and yellow like we're used to and that I've done in the previous videos and we've talked about our three primary colors when we're talking watercolor. However, I have been wondering about the colors that you see when you exchange the cartridges in your printer. They are not blue, red and yellow. They are cyan, which is like a turquoisey blue, magenta, which is a purpley red, and then yellow. So I went ahead and looked in my binder with my color swatches, this one here that I have with all my colors, and I went ahead and found the three colors. So the three colors I picked was Peacock Blue, and this one's from Holbein, Quinacridone Magenta, this one happens to be Winsor Newton, but it doesn't matter. And then I picked my yellow, the Nickel Azo Yellow, or in some brands it's called Transparent Yellow, and it's PY150. So those are the three colors that I find are most like the colors I put in my printer. So here's the magenta, here's the yellow, and here's the cyan, they call it. I haven't found a color in any of the brands, watercolor brands, that they call cyan. But the closest that I found in my collection was the Peacock Blue from Holbein, this one here. And then you can, if you don't have Peacock Blue, because it is a little bit of a, maybe not most, you know, standard color. If you have phthalo blue in a green shade, that would be it. That one would work just as well. And if you don't happen to have Quinacridone Magenta, I would say Quinacridone Rose or Permanent Rose would be a good substitute for the red. So it's basically, it is red, blue and yellow, only our blue is a cool blue, so it's more towards the turquoise. It has, you know, a little bit of yellow in it, and the yellow is pretty standard middle of the road yellow, and then the magenta is of course a pinkish purpley red, so it's a cool red. So let's see how that's going to work out. So why don't you go through your paints and pick the three new primary colors for this experiment, and then we'll reconvene here. I'll face the camera down so you can see what I'm doing. You don't need to look at my face. I did put lipstick on and I did comb my hair today. So why don't you go through your paints and find the three colors that is most like the colors that you put in your printer, a magenta or pink, a yellow and a cool blue. So whatever you have, grab them, and then let's try to make a color wheel using these three colors and see what happens. Here you can see, here are my three colors that I picked. Quinacridone Magenta, Peacock Blue, and Nickel Azo Yellow. And this one happens to be, the magenta happens to be from Winsor Newton, and this one, Peacock Blue, is the one from Holbein, and I actually picked the Nickel Azo Yellow from M. Graham, but it doesn't matter. Brand does not matter. Professional watercolors are definitely to be preferred. As you know, that's what I prefer. And then I actually grabbed a new palette because I'm gonna build this out once we've done this video, and once I've tried that, to paint that color wheel and see what colors I get from these three colors, so I can see what additional colors would be nice to add to this particular palette. You know, I like this palette. It's Jane E. Jones travel palette, and it has 12 wells here that I like to limit myself to 12 colors most of the time. So you can see I've already put some of the paint out. I also did my usual guide for my palette. You know, I like to have a color guide for my palette. So right now I've just put these three colors on, and I like to put them on full strength, and then I water it down, so you can see there, and then I still need to lift out, but I'm gonna wait until I have filled it out. And I have just used some skinny tape that I found online. I'll put a link to it down below in the show notes underneath the video here. And this is, I think it's like 1/4 inch, is that what it is? Yeah, 1/4 inch blue tape, and it comes in a 3-pack. So I use that, so I mean, it's just, I've gotten a little bit more particular as the years go on with my guide. I like them to look nice, actually, so that's why I like to use the tape. And here is a color wheel I've done in the past with my standard primary colors, which is transparent yellow, which is the same as Nickel Azo Yellow, French Ultramarine Blue, which is actually a warmer blue, but it's very, I mean, there's no such thing really as a true blue. And then there's a Quinacridone Red as my true red, and you can see the colors I get from that, and you can see I get some pretty greens, but they're more muted. I do get nice oranges, and the purples are pretty okay too. It's mainly in this particular, with these three colors, primary colors, it's the greens where you don't really get a bright green. And I've already prepped I use one of these here if you have one. Otherwise, just, you know, grab a plate, or you can use anything round as a guide. It's just easier with this, I don't know what it's called in English. I think it's called a compass, but I'm not sure. Where you have the circle, you have the center, and then you can go, it's every 30 degrees that gives you 12 slots, which is what you want. And so I already did that, and I'm using a new watercolor block that I bought. It's Arches cold press, 140 pound in a block like this, that's taped all the way around, and then it has this opening here. That's the perfect size for a color wheel, and the size is 7.9 times 7.9, so almost 8 by 8, and it's 20 centimeters by 20 centimeters for those of you that are in Europe or in other places of the world where they use the metric system, which is my preferred system. But here in the United States of America, we have not switched over to what the rest of the world uses yet. Can you hear that? I'm originally from Denmark, and I grew up with a metric system, and I'm still annoyed that Americans haven't switched. Anyway, that's a whole different discussion. Has nothing to do with art, so we'll move on. So here are the colors, and here, you know, I grabbed three old cartridges from one of my printers that uses these three colors for the color side of it, and I picked another one from one of my other printers, and you can see there that it has black and black, and but then it has cyan, magenta, and yellow, and it's called CMYK. I don't know what the K stands for. Cyan, magenta, yellow, and then the K, I'm not quite sure. So that's what I have prepared, and what I'm going to do now is I'm going to first paint in the slices of the primary colors that we're going to use for this color wheel, and I like to use tape, and I happen to have 1-inch blue tape here, and so that's what I'm going to be using. So it doesn't really matter where you start. And so I like, again, just for neatness sake, I like to tape off my little triangles here so I can get nice straight lines. And I'm not going to bore you with painting this whole color wheel for you. I'm just going to start out, and if you want to see me paint a color wheel, I have several YouTube videos with that if you really would love to see how I do that. I already got the colors out. Let me just start with the peacock blue. And the way I like to do my color wheels is putting clean water in about 2/3, starting from the tip and working up towards where the circle is. And then I'm gonna get full strength of this peacock blue, and I'm gonna move it around so that it's easy. I'm left-handed, so it's easiest for me to paint this way. And I start up here in the dry part, and so you don't want to dilly-dally too much. And I want to have full strength up here, and then I just move down, and it becomes more watered down. I think I need a little bit more full strength up here, just so we get the full. Yeah, that's good enough. And then I have to let that dry. That's why, it's not fun for you to watch. So I'm going to do that with the three other colors. The only thing I want to say to you is, I can take this off right away so nothing creeps under. And so then I have to count 1, 2, 3, number 4. That's where I'm going to put either the yellow or the magenta. And then the other side, the same thing. 1, 2, 3, skip 1. And then there's 3 in between those. That's how you want to have 3 empty spaces between your 3 primary colors, okay? And once I've done that, we are going to reconvene, and then comes the excitement and the fun part, and that is to see how these colors, what secondary colors they will create, and if we actually will get a true red, a true blue, true yellow. We already have pretty much. So that's what we're going to explore today. That's gonna be kind of fun. And then the last thing I want to explore with you, once we've done that, is I want to explore if we can create a black out of these three colors, because we do need to be able to create darks, like really darks. Anyway, I'll see you in a bit, and you could go ahead and create your own color wheel, draw it out in pencil, and then put the three primary colors, what is closest to a cyan, magenta, and then a yellow. And you can see the yellow that they use is, I would say, kind of pretty much a true yellow. It's not really orangey, it's not really greenish, cool yellow. So anyway, and that's where I
find that my all-time favorite yellow, nickel azo yellow, transparent yellow, PY150, is ideal for that.
So here you can see, just getting the third color in, the magenta. Skip three in between each of the colors. Getting water on the two-thirds about from the tip. And that way I can get a nice gradated wash. Flipping it around so it's easier for me. Make sure you don't have any drips on your handle. And then just go in full strength. You're in the dry part. And then just drag it down there. So there we have it. And I'm just going to pull the tape away right away. And then comes the fun part. We'll see how these three colors will interact and create the secondary colors in between. Alrighty, everything is nice and dry, and we are going to start with the magenta going towards the yellow. So we're going to take the magenta, we're not going to go magenta, and put a little bit of yellow in, and then hopefully we should get something that would be considered a true red. So here's our magenta, and then I'm just going to grab another brush, this little one with the work, and then I'm going to put some yellow in. Like this. And I'm thinking maybe we need just a little bit more of the yellow. Not too much, just a little bit. And I'm going to do the same as we did when we did the pure colors. Put water in the first two thirds from the tip. And here we go. It's too watery. So we need more full strength, the magenta. And then we need some full strength of the yellow. You want to have, you know, a full strength color to start with there. That's better. And that's a rich red we get out of that. It reminds me a lot of alizarin crimson that I painted with the other day when I did the peony. If you didn't watch that one, you can watch it here. I put the link up in the corner. And there we have that. And I'm going to pull off the tape right away. And it's a little wet, so it's going to let it run down a little bit. But can you see? I don't know how well, you know, it shows up on the camera, hopefully well enough. So we're going to have to let that dry and then we can continue. And the next one we are going to do is we're going to do more yellow, and so we should get an orange and then more yellow, so we get a yellow orange. So we'll see how that works out. Okay, now that this one's dry, we can paint the next little triangle, adding on some more yellow to the original mixture that we had. So just gonna give these colors a little whiff of water, not too much, because you know, don't want it too watered down. And then before I do anything, I'm gonna put the water in about two-thirds up and put some more yellow in to get a nice orange. Feel we need a little bit more of the yellow. Go, nice orange. I think I'm good here. Start out here, full strength, and then we pull it down. There we go. And we'll let that dry. All right, so this dried, and as you can see, it's a nice orange, but it's not quite as bright as one would see when using a warmer red, but still a very acceptable orange, I think. And with a little tweak, it would be awesome for skin tones. Okay, got my tape on. So the next one is more yellow into the magenta. So let's see what we can find here. Here, adding quite a bit of yellow to it, so we get that yellow orange with a more yellow than magenta. I think this would be good. I forgot that I should have wet the first two-thirds here. I can do that with this brush instead. There we go. Should get enough water on there. All right, let's do it. I think that's good. So this has more of the yellow in it. So it's almost like a, close to like maybe a new gamboge. Only, of course, this one will be transparent because both my colors are transparent. Whoops. Looks like I didn't press my tape down well enough. Go in and just dab that off right away. Even though this is just a color wheel, I do like it to look as clean as possible. Go. The yellow, nickel azo yellow or transparent yellow pigment 150, PY150, travels a lot. It's a mover and a shaker, so we'll let this dry, and then we can move over to create our greens. Okay, so our yellow-orange dried, and I think, I mean, it's a pretty okay range of orange in between the magenta and the yellow, and this can totally go for a true red. So now we're moving over to the next secondary color, which is green, and that's the yellow and the blue in various mixes. So let's see how that goes. Just gonna put my little tape on here. This time I'm really gonna try and see if I can press it down so I don't get too much run in. And here, so this is this little triangle that's closest to the yellow, which means that the yellow will be
be dominant, so it'll be a yellow-green. So here's my peacock blue puddle, and here's my yellow puddle. So I'm going to put a little bit of peacock blue in there, like that. And I think, actually, I needed more yellow to get the color. So I have, you know, I have three triangles to move over, so, you know, I don't want to start out too green. So this will be more like a green gold, which is a color I like. So very, very springy green. It's a little too green, too much blue in it. So that tells me that that peacock is very, very strong, because normally this transparent yellow is super duper strong, which it is, but it's met its match here in the peacock blue, that's for sure. And you'll find the same if you're using the phthalo green, that's also a very, very strong staining color. So here we go. I'm actually still feeling I want it even more yellow. Maybe I'll just actually use this brush. Doesn't matter what brush you use. This is more what I'm after. Have it. Just move it in the water here and make sure I get it nice and strong up here. So there's that color, like a green gold. Oh, it still ran under. What the heck is going on here? That side is good. Okay, so I just dab it up, and then we'll have to wait for this to dry before I can do the next one. So it seems like the colors really want to run into this yellow side. I don't know what that's about, but we can dab it off so that it looks somewhat nicer. And we're just going to wait for this to dry, and then we'll continue. So our green gold, yellow green, has dried. Got a little bit of a not so pretty area there, but we're gonna overlook that. And it's not about that, it's about the colors. So I can already tell you that I am slightly surprised that my green gold here is not quite as bright and pure as I had thought it would be. And it is a subject for another video that I'm going to do after I'm done with this one here, and I'll link it up in the corner and give you the link below so we can discuss that in depth. But right now I just wanted to carry on with the color wheel here as I've laid it out. But for some of you that might not have used the peacock blue as your blue, but have used your phthalo blue instead, you will most likely, is my guess, have a much brighter green gold, and we'll discuss why in my next video. So here, that, and some water in, and let me just try and see if I can really press down here. I always did on that one. So then we're hoping that that'll do it. And then we put our water in, about 2/3 down this triangle, slice of pie, whatever you want to call it. And then we have our colors here, and here was that was the one I painted onto there. And then here is the one that I thought was a little too green, too much blue in. So now we just add a little bit more blue so we get the correct color. And so this here would be our green, like true green, if you can say, where it's kind of like in between the yellow and the peacock blue. And then just drag it down like this. That dry. And before I go any further, I'm gonna try and remove my tape and see how I did this time. Ha! Much better. Still a little bit of run back right there, but here, clean as a whistle. All right, so I'm just gonna do this, and that could be off camera, you know. So I put the tape down, I put the water in, and then I'm gonna mix my next blue green. So more blue and less yellow. I think this is about right what I got here. So let's try it out. That's a beautiful color, I love it. That's the color I could get behind. Really love it. Strengthen here, and then let's run it down. Yeah, and then we'll let that dry. So here you can see I started painting my circles. First I painted the primary color, peacock, quinacridone magenta, and a nickel azo yellow, a transparent yellow. And then I painted in one of the smaller circles with the complementary color. So to magenta, it's the green that's across from it, this green here. And for the peacock blue, it's the orange. And it's this orange that is a little bit more on the red side. And I haven't done the yellow yet because I haven't painted in the complementary purple there. But then I mixed the magenta with the green and I got this neutral, which is a kind of a warm neutral. And I could have tweaked it to more cool or even warmer or more neutral, but this is what I came up with. And then here, the complementary color to the peacock was this orange that's a little bit more on the warmer side. And then I mixed those two together and I got a nice neutral color. Whoops, you can't see it. So I got a nice neutral color here, you can see. I had the peacock that I mixed with the orange that is a little bit more on the warmer, redder side of the orange, because that's what's across on the color wheel. And I got this nice neutral brownish grayish color. And that's as far as I've gotten. So it has dried and we are ready to get the next purple on, adding in some more precise, adding in a little bit more of the peacock blue. Press this down really well and get some water in first 2/3. There we go. And then here is our purple. Need a little bit more water. It's dried in the meantime. Make a nice purple. Adding in some more peacock blue so it's a cooler purple. I think this is about right. Need a little bit more water in it so that it will flow off my brush. And there's a good, beautiful purple. It really, really does make some awesome purples here, that's for sure. That's that magenta. It is a good, strong color. It's a fabulous color for any kind of purples you want. Let's strike it down. And I think that's pretty good. Strengthen a little bit up here. That's good. And then we're going to pull those off. And then we'll wait till it's dry. And then we can do the last one. And then do the last circles we have. Our purple dried nicely. And now we just have the last one left. Closer to the peacock blue. So this area that I'm painting here, this little triangle here, is actually going to be the one that is the closest to a true blue, because remember, our peacock blue is a turquoisey blue, so it's not a true blue. So let's see how this goes. I already started mixing here. So look at this color. It's very close to actually French ultramarine blue, I think. Let's see how we do. So that is peacock blue with quinacridone magenta. Pull it down like this. Make sure we get it nice and strong up here. I think I might have gotten it a little dark here, so I'm just going to lift up just a little bit in the tip there. Okay, last one. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? And it's still wet, of course. A little bleed in here. But look at that color. Can you see how that is like more of a true blue? So we have our little areas here. So we needed to get the purple. And that's... don't want it too watery. Or purple. It's going to be across from the yellow. And I'll put it here. So the purples are definitely very bright and nice. The only secondary color that is a little bit toned down, I would say, is the orange. Because of the fact that there's quite a bit of blue in the magenta. So here's a nice purple. Complementary color to the yellow, of course. And then we're going to take our purple and we're going to put some yellow in to get that neutral. See what we can do here. Get a nice neutral there. I think that's going to be pretty much it. And that's the neutral we got from mixing the purple and the yellow. So you can see each neutral has a little bit of a different tone. And of course you can push it depending on how much or how little of each individual complementary pair you put in. So there we have that. And then the last test I wanted to do, that is taking our three primary colors and mix them to see how, you know, if we can get a really nice dark, almost black. So I am going to bring out some yellow, grab another brush, some blue, peacock blue, and we don't want too much water here. That's why I'm doing it with the different brushes here. And then I'm going to grab this brush here and get some of the magenta, quinacridone magenta. Look how beautiful and bright that is. That's really a great color. Okay, so we're going to try and get these colors together and see what kind of a dark we can get out of that. So I want it as neutral as possible. So it looks like I need a little bit more magenta. I'll take the water out. I think that's pretty good there. A little bit more of the yellow in. Okay, then we just need to get a little bit more water on so that we can actually spread the color. Of course, that was the one thing I was not 100% sure if that peacock blue was too light to give us a good dark, but I think it works. However, I want to show you why I have decided I don't think the peacock blue is the best one for the primary color blue in this cyan yellow magenta color wheel. There we go. That's pretty good. That's actually pretty darn good there. So here we have it, our completed color wheel, where we have used alternatives to the three primary colors, red, blue, and yellow. We used a peacock blue, which is a cool blue that is leaning towards the yellow side. We used a quinacridone magenta, which is a pink red leaning over towards the
purple and blue. So it's a cool red. So we have a cool blue, we have a cool red, and then we have a pretty standard middle of the road neutral yellow, which is our Nickel Azo yellow. And we created our color wheel by using those three for our primary colors. And so you have your peacock blue here, you have your quinacridone magenta there, and you have your Nickel Azo yellow there. And so you can see what we consider true primary colors have like shifted, because once we move one step towards the magenta with the peacock blue, we get more of a true blue. And the same with the magenta, when we move one step towards the yellow, we get more of a true red, and the yellow is the same. And maybe our oranges didn't, they're not quite as bright as we would maybe see them with the traditional color wheel, but they're pretty darn close. And our greens are definitely bright. The only one that we have a little bit where I feel it was not as bright as I had anticipated, that is the first one between the peacock blue and the yellow. That would be more of the green gold, like from Daniel Smith, for instance. And it's not quite as bright. It's a little bit more olivey. And in another video, I'm going to explore and explain why that is. So stay tuned for that. And I am happy with the black that we could create from mixing the three primary colors. It really is a nice black, neutral black that we could create. So my fear that the peacock blue was not dark enough to make that happen was not founded. So it's fine for that. So that was a little different view on colors. And I hope you found this interesting, and maybe you want to try out some color wheels and some new colors yourself. It's always fun to try something new and explore and learn. So with that, I wish you happy painting, and I'll see you soon in another video.